Good morning, students. Today's class is lecture 1 under module 4, and in this module we will be discussing about the biomass pretreatment. Okay, so this is one of the most important aspect of the entire biomass conversion or biorefinery concept. So in today's class we will discuss about what are the barriers that exist for the lignocellulosic biomass conversion and what are the different types of pretreatment technologies that are commercially adapted one by one. Okay. So, lignocellulose is the most abundantly available, inexpensive and renewable raw material. Lignocellulosic biomass is being investigated as a promising feedstock for the production of alternative fuels, chemicals and materials. The production of commercially available chemicals and biofuels using lignocellulose based processes has the potential to decrease greenhouse gas emissions, bring benefits to rural economies and promote energy security. The composition of lignocellulosic biomass varies with biomass source. So, hardwood, softwood, agriculture residue, energy crops, municipal solid waste, all these things, and is affected by the origin, age, climatic conditions, harvesting and storage processes. So, some of these things we already know during our subsequent classes we have discussed this. Now, please have a look to this particular table where the chemical composition of various lignocellulosic biomass has been listed. And the source has also been given, you can later on see. So, you see it is basically listed under 3 different categories, okay, the cellulose, hemicellulose and lignin. Please understand that apart from this there are some other materials also, there are proteins, there are volatile materials, as all these things. Okay. Now, the main chemical building blocks of lignocellulosic biomass that includes actually cellulose, almost about 35 to 50%, hemicellulose is 20 to 35%, and lignin which varies from 15 to 20%. Now, the composition varies and depends on cultivation conditions, geographical location and the age of plants. Now, please see that, let us see this corn straw or oat straw. Okay. You see this, it is almost 39-42, in that range is the cellulose. And hemicellulose is from 27-21 in that range, and lignin is 10 to 20 in that range. Okay. Now, you come to bagasse, here the cellulose is little more. Now, you come to aspen, this forestry residues, the cellulose amount increased basically. Okay. So, there are so many things. Now, if you come to solid cattle manure, you can see the cellulose, hemicellulose and lignin, all the 3 major components are very less. There are other components which are more predominantly in that particular material. Okay. So, likewise the understanding is that, so the cellulose, hemicellulose, lignin varies apart from other materials, and the process or the technologies for converting this biomass, okay, including that of course, the pretreatment technologies should be developed in such a way that any process can consider or can take the various multiple feedstocks, okay, rather than developing a process for a singular two feedstocks. So, please have a look at this particular slide. Okay, you see that one class long back I think we have discussed how the cellulose, hemicellulose and lignin actually intricately bind together. Okay, this is again it is telling. So, you please see that how the cellulose is the blue part, okay, lignin is the green part, and the hemicellulose is the red part, okay, or the orange, whatever it is, will be visible from your side. Okay. So, these are intricately bind together. Okay. So, that is the reason why we are talking about in today's class pretreatment. Why the pretreatment is required? Because I want or we want this cellulose and hemicellulose to be disintegrated, because it is bound together, cellulose, hemicellulose, lignin, all are bound together, we need to disintegrate them. Then you need to take out the cellulose and hemicellulose part, we will go for hydrolysis, we will get C6 and C5 sugars, then that will be fermented to bioethanol, alcohol platforms and other chemicals. Okay. Now, lignocellulosic biomass is composed of cellulose, hemicellulose tightly packed and protected by phenol, aldehyde, lignin polymer. And the polysaccharide fractions of lignocellulosic biomass including cellulose and hemicellulose can be broken down into sugar monomers. Now, they are then converted into biofuels, biogas and biochemicals through biotechnological platforms such as anaerobic digestion and fermentation. Now, lignocellulosic biomass consists of carbohydrate fractions such as cellulose and hemicellulose, and non-carbohydrate fractions like lignin, protein and other extractives or volatile matters basically. So, cellulose and hemicellulose, which are polysaccharides in the biomass, can be converted to bioethanol, biobutanol and other fermentation products through various biological pathways. They can also be transformed into furan based chemicals and other organic acids by thermochemical pathways, but either it is a pyrolysis or gasification, any such processes. So, for effective conversion of these carbohydrates, it is necessary to overcome and or reduce the recalcitrance of biomass prior to the conversion processes. Biomass recalcitrance is defined as the natural resistance of plant cell walls for its biological conversion, mainly caused by the complexity and heterogeneity of biomass. Now, the recalcitrant nature of lignocellulosic biomass presents a technical challenge for releasing fermentable sugars from the biomass and a major hurdle in its use in biorefinery. Several phenotypes of biomass have been evaluated as recalcitrant factors. So, some of these are listed here. The first is the chemical composition, and second is the molecular weight of lignin. Lignin syringeal or guarcyl unit, okay, we'll discuss about this later on little, okay. Cellulose crystallinity, then degree of polymerization of cellulose and cellulose accessibility. So, let us talk about cellulose, okay. So, we will try to understand what are the various components, their composition and their role in the recalcitrant nature of the lignocellulosic biomass. Now, you know cellulose is one of the most abundantly available material on the earth, natural material, okay. So, the composition of lignocellulosic biomass varies with plant species, age, stage of growth and season, this is well understood. And cellulose is a linear polymer composed of D glucose units linked together by the beta 1,4 glycosidic bonds. So, this is a classical structure of the single cellulose molecule. So, the degree of polymerization is approximately 4000 to 6000 glucose in woody biomass. Polymers of cellulose are interlinked through hydrogen and van der Waals bond to form a microfibril and present in crystalline and amorphous form. Now, these microfibrils are covered by hemicellulose and lignin and intricately actually packed. So, crystalline cellulose fiber parts attach to each other by non-covalent hydrogen bonding, which provides 3 to 30 times lower degradability as compared to the amorphous part. Now, cellulase, that is the enzyme which will degrade cellulose, okay, is readily able to hydrolyze more accessible amorphous cellulose, but it is not effective at degrading the less accessible crystalline portion. Now, that is the reason why we are going for pretreatment. Now, let us understand hemicellulose. So, this is a classical structure of a hemicellulose molecule, okay. So, hemicellulose, the second most abundant heterogeneously branched polymer, is composed of pentoses, so D xylose and L arabinose hexoses, such as D glucose, D mannose and D galactose. Then apart from this sugar units, there are certain acetyl groups and uronic acids. So, the degree of polymerization is as high as 50 to 300 monosaccharide units. Hemicellulose lacks a crystalline structure owing to its branch structure and the presence of acetyl group, and it is easily degradable owing to its amorphous nature. So, this is how, what is the basic difference between structural difference between cellulose and hemicellulose, where cellulose is more recalcitrant in nature, hemicellulose is little less than cellulose in recalcitrance. So, the composition of hemicellulose varies with plant species. Softwood hemicellulose components are galactoglucomannan and arabinoglucuronoxylan, while glucuronoxylan is the main component of hemicellulose in hardwood. Hemicellulose acts as a physical barrier and restricts the accessibility of cellulase to cellulose. Removal of hemicellulose with pretreatment methods such as acid or steam hydrolysis and the addition of enzymes, okay, increases the cellulose hydrolysis. So, then lignin, okay. So, lignin is the most complex amorphous polyphenolics polymer composed of 3 methoxylated p hydrophenyl propionate units, so which are known as monolignons, as for example p coumaryl, coniferyl and sinapyl alcohol. So, you can see the structure of this p coumaryl alcohol, coniferyl alcohol and sinapyl alcohol, and that of the lignin, okay. So, these monomer units give rise to p hydroxyphenyl, which is known as H, guacil, which is known as Z, and syringyl, which is known as S, subunits, when incorporated into a lignin polymer. So, this H, G and S, they are intricately bound together and linked together to form the complex lignin molecule or structure. So, depending on the biomass source, lignin composition varies with the change in the ratio of different monomer units. So, gymnosperms, or we can say that softwood plants, okay, and fern lignin are generally composed of G as the main component, followed by a small amount of H unit. Now, contrastingly, in angiosperm, that is hardwood plants, lignin is mainly composed of S units followed by G units. So, more of S followed by less of G. Okay. So, the main lignin components of herbaceous crops are G followed by H and S. So, from this statements, we will understand basically that this H, S and G, depending upon how much amount they are present, the softness or hardness is basically decided. Okay. So, various monomer units are linked through this beta O4 aryl ether bonds, and lignin acts as glue around the cellulose and hemicellulose fibers, and its main function is to provide mechanical strength and support for the formation of vascular tissue, for the transport of nutrients, and to promote resistance against microbial attack. So, this is the main function of lignin in plants. And lignin makes biomass recalcitrant by restricting the accessibility of cellulose enzyme to cellulose, and by preventing the deactivation of enzymes by various lignin derived compounds. So, this is the figure which will tell about this main component of lignocellulosic biomass, the how intricately they are actually bound together. So, the biomass, this is a typical plant cell microscopic image. This is the macrofibril, okay, and this is the microfibril. So, in the microfibril, you can see that how lignin, okay, which is this rod shaped green shown here, okay, then this one cellulose, okay, and hemicellulose, this brown portion. So, you can understand that that looks like scattered, but they are intricately bound together with each other. So, we need to actually disintegrate this entire structure, okay, so that we get cellulose and of course, hemicellulose also. So, lignocellulosic biomass recalcitrance is the natural resistance of plant cells against microbial degradation, animal attacks and other environmental conditions. Now, along with the structural components, there are other factors that influence recalcitrance. So, some of them are acetyl groups and proteins and the porosity of the biomass. In table 2, we will learn more about that. So, acetyl groups bind hemicellulose via covalent ester bonds, and deacetylation of biomass may increase lignocellulose degradation by 5 to 7 times. Now, this recalcitrance property is a bottleneck in industrial utilization of lignocellulosic biomass, and various pretreatments are required to overcome this issue. Proteins also have negative and positive influences on recalcitrance. Some proteins help to break hydrogen bonds between polysaccharides, which improves degradation, while some proteins inhibit the activity of various hydrolases. So, hydrolases are the enzymes that are responsible for doing the hydrolysis. So, to overcome the inhibitory effects of various proteins, usually dried lignocellulosic materials are used in the biorefinery as drying and storage of biomass denature proteins, right. So, the physical structure which includes the accessible surface area, we call it ASA or ASA, okay, particle size and pore volume of the material plays an important role in the biomass recalcitrance. Higher ASA provides more surface area for enzymes during hydrolysis. Ultra fine grinding leads to smaller particle sizes, leading to changes in polymerization and porosity, and enhances enzymatic hydrolysis. When you are grinding them to finer particle size, basically you are increasing the surface area and thereby resulting in more degradation. Okay. The pore size of the biomass also has an important role as enzymes, which can only enter the pores of a specific size, because enzyme has a certain size. Okay. So, this is the table 2, let us understand what is being given here, and this is the reference of this particular table. So, effect of lignocellulosic biomass composition and physical structure on recalcitrance, right. So, this is the pretreatment method, okay, of chemical method and physical method, okay. So, the components are lignin, hemicellulose, acetyl, proteins, then in under physical, we will be talking about crystallinity, degree of polymerization, particle size, pore size and surface area. This is what we have already discussed, okay. So, in a nutshell, whatever we have discussed is been presented in this particular table. So, please refer to it later on. We will just quickly glance through it. So, lignin acts as a physical barrier and restricts accessibility to cellulose. Lignin derived compounds have inhibitory effects on hydrolysis. That is very important. Okay. So, when you do this hydrolysis, okay, and there are certain byproducts that will be created, which are not required at all, and which are sometimes many times are toxic to the entire process. So, you need to get rid of them. So, lignin plays a very important role in making such or generating such byproducts. That is why lignin has to be removed completely. Hemicellulose acts as the physical barrier and restricts the accessibility of cellulose enzyme to cellulose. Acetyl group interferes with enzyme recognition. Okay. Proteins will have both positive and negative effects on hydrolysis. Crystallinity tells us that hydrolysis rate of amorphous cellulose is almost 30 times higher than the crystalline cellulose. Okay. So, that is why more crystalline the cellulose we need to have a better pretreatment technology, and we need to spend more energy, chemicals and all these things to make the higher crystalline cellulose amenable to hydrolysis. Okay. And there are other things, please go through it later on. Right. Now, we will discuss about the pretreatment of lignocellulosic biomass, the different methods. Okay. And the conversion of lignocellulosic biomass requires pretreatment to transform the biomass for the fermentation process. Pretreatment is also needed to break the rigid structure of lignin and hemicelluloses and to release cellulose for the enzymatic hydrolysis. Pretreatment will cause changes in both micro and macro structure of lignocelluloses and initiate modifications in the chemical composition of lignocelluloses. The pretreatment methods aid in the alteration of the natural structure of lignocellulose for the microbial attack in the decomposition process. The pretreatment process helps break down lignin and hemicellulose that surround cellulose to release cellulose from the cell. The process involves the removal of lignin and the degradation of hemicelluloses, which causes the alteration in cellulose crystalline structure, and subsequently it releases the cellulose. This process helps the interaction of enzymes and substrate, which enhances the hydrolysis process. Pretreatment process ought to be straightforward, environmental friendly, economical and efficient. So, it has to be like that, otherwise it will not be an sustainable process and cannot be a part of the biorefinery. So, additionally, the pretreatment method must not cause in the rise of inhibitory compounds. This is what I was just mentioning. Okay. So, these inhibitory compounds formation should be restricted by choosing a particular pretreatment method, which will not create a greater amount of such inhibitory compounds. So, up to date, no synchronized pretreatment approach that matches the whole variety of lignocellulosic biomass, and the process of pretreatment varies according to the type of lignocellulosic biomass and preferred products. Now, this is what I was mentioning in the beginning of the class. You have to note it, it is a very serious thing actually. When we are talking about this pretreatment processes, or whether when we are talking about the entire biorefinery concept, we need to understand that the pretreatment cost is almost 40%, okay, if you talk about the entire cost of the product. Now, why it is 40% right now, or almost in that range? The reason is that first thing is that whatever pretreatment techniques are available, these are suitable for certain particular types of biomass. So, no pretreatment technology, not a single one, or a hybrid technology has been developed which will take into account so many different types of multiple feedstocks, okay, because there are different feedstocks will have different components. Some will have higher cellulose, some will have very low amount of hemicellulose, some will have very high amount of lignin. So, it all depends. Okay. So, that is the reason why we need to work on more to develop more efficient pretreatment technologies, which will be economical, which will also take less time, which will not be energy intensive, and then which will be sustainable. Okay. And which will, again I am telling you, that must be able to take into account multiple feedstocks, or take into account means will be able to process multiple feedstocks. Okay. So, that is very important. So, the following criteria lead to an improvement in the enzymatic hydrolysis of lignocellulosic material. The first is increasing the surface area and porosity, which can be done by doing the mechanical processing. Modification of the lignin structure. Now, modification of the lignin structure can be done by genetic engineering aspect. In one of our class, we have discussed that you have to remove lignin. So, this is a delignification process. You call this one pretreatment also. Then partial depolymerization of the hemicellulose. So, you have to release hemicellulose also, or depolymerize also, so that hemicellulose which is bound to cellulose will be disintegrated. Then remove hemicellulose, because hemicellulose also can be hydrolyzed and converted to the sugar, and then reducing the crystallinity of the cellulose. Okay. So, once you do the pretreatment, you can see how it is intricately bound. Okay. So, this is the lignin, the green one is cellulose, and this thread type, whatever it is being shown here, is hemicellulose. you disintegrate that, that means you treat it, okay, delignify it, and it will be disintegrated something like this. Hemicellulose is pure, lignin in the purest form, cellulose in the purest form, okay. Let us understand the pretreatment methods, okay. So, we have two different broad categories of pretreatment method. First one is biological, the second is the non-biological. So, in the biological, we can have fungi based pretreatment methods, we can have bacteria based or archaea based, okay. And in under non-biological, we have varieties of pretreatment methods, some are physical, some are chemical, and some are physicochemical. So, in today's class, we will discuss few of them, and some we will discuss in our next class. So, these are some of the methods I have listed. There are many which are not listed here also. So, physical, under physical, it can be myelin, microwave, ultrasound, pyrolysis. Under chemical, it is acid treatment, alkali treatment, ozonolysis, organosolvent process, and ionic liquids. Ionic liquids are a excellent class of green solvents. And then physicochemical, hot water treatment, steam explosion, ammonia based treatment, wet oxidation, and carbon dioxide explosion. Some of these physicochemical treatment and chemical treatments are, of course, they are costly. Okay. Now, this particular slide will show you that whatever we have just told you in the earlier slide, it is presented in a better way here. So, classification of the lignocellulosic biomass pretreatment methods in detail. Physical, okay, extrusion, pulsed electric energy based, liquid hot water, pyrolysis, irradiation, which will basically the microwave treatment, okay, mechanical milling, grinding, chipping. When you come to chemical, it is again acid, alkali, solvolysis, that means using the organosolvents, okay, oxidative using either oxygen, then ozone, and then hydrogen peroxide, then ionic liquid, okay, different types of ionic liquids are there, and hydrotrops like sodium benzoate and salts, certain metal salts, okay. Then we have physicochemical, so steam explosion, ammonia fiber explosion, FX, it is a very interesting and very efficient technique, okay. But you have to do it in a proper way, okay. Otherwise, there are risks associated with that. Anyway, we will discuss later, okay. So, ultrasound assisted chemical pretreatment, this is one of the most efficient processes, but however, it has its own limitation, okay. Now, beyond certain limit, it cannot work, and it is a low cost technology, though a certain amount of energy is required. Then, microwave assisted chemical pretreatment, not only microwave, microwave assisted chemical pretreatment. Then microwave assisted pyrolysis, okay. Then combined pretreatments. So, this is called hybrid, okay. More work is being done here. So, it is a combination of one or two different pretreatment methods. Then biological, based on enzymes, microorganisms, and development of suitable microbial consortium to take care of the pretreatments, okay. So, this is the bioconversion of lignocellulosic biomass into value added products with the inclusion of the pretreatment steps. So, this is your biomass, okay, and this is the structure. So, you pretreat here biological, chemical, physical, physicochemical, anything we get, and that will result in something, the disintegration of the structure of the lignin, cellulose, and hemicellulose. Then you convert them, cellulose, hemicellulose will be basically purified, okay. So, you hydrolyze them, so then you can any biochemical or biotechnological platform, okay, such as fermentation, anaerobic digestion, so you get alcohol platforms, okay, bio, it can be bioethanol, it can be biobutanol, okay, or then we can have biogas also. Next is lignin, so lignin either it can go for pyrolysis, gasification in or with or without the presence of catalysis. So, we can get biopolymers, we will get aromatic hydrocarbons, okay, and other value-added chemicals. So, physical methods of biomass pretreatment we will discuss, okay. So, in general, physical pretreatment is responsible for the changes in specific surface area, particle sizes, crystallinity index, and polymerization degree of biomass. Now, physical pretreatment avoids the use of chemicals, thus reducing the generation of waste and inhibitors for subsequent reaction. Now, mechanical, microwave, or ultrasound pretreatments are the most common techniques carried out in order to improve the efficiency of the main steps in the biomass processing. So, let us understand mechanical pretreatment. Now, the advantages of mechanical pretreatment of lignocellulosic materials are reduction of particle size, increase of specific surface area and bulk density, and as well as reduction of the amount of chemical waste. So, higher bulk density helps with handling of biomass after harvesting, storage, and transport. In turn, lower particle sizes as well as an increase in the specific surface area makes the chemical or physical processing easier due to development of a phase boundary between lignocellulosic material and chemicals and elimination of heat transport limitation. Now, the main disadvantage of mechanical pretreatment is the high energy consumption, which contributes to high processing cost of lignocellulosic materials. These are some of the schematic or representation of the mechanical pretreatment processes. This is a hammer mill, okay, where milling is done. This is an extruder, okay, for the extrusion process. That's a ball mill where small balls are present to disintegrate or reduce the size of the biomass. This is an air mill and that's a rod mill. So all are mechanical operation processes basically, okay. So, where do we apply this actually? So, the effectiveness of milling, chipping and massing pretreatments of Norway spruce, it is a example here, okay, where compared for enzymatic hydrolysis of this feedstock into when it is being converted into biobutanol. Now, pretreatment with ball milling gave the lowest particle size of the spruce in comparison to massing or chipping, but resulted in low hydrolysis efficiency. Now, application of extrusion has the large potential in the pretreatment of lignocellulosic materials for biogas production. Researchers have applied a twin screw extruder in vine trimming suits pretreatment for methane production in an anaerobic digestion. Now, treated samples generated around almost 15% to 21% of more biogas compared to untreated material. So, it is a very good finding, okay, with physical treatment. So, it was observed that an extrusion reduces the amount of hemicellulose fraction by around 50%, simultaneously increasing the fraction of soluble chemicals like carbohydrates, proteins, lipids, minerals and vitamins, which are rapidly converted by methanogenic microorganisms, hence increasing methane production. However, this investigation proved that use of ball milling has only a small impact on the process efficiency. So, this is the selected examples of the studies concerning mechanical pretreatment, okay. So, I leave it to you, please have a look later on. So, you can see that there are different types of biomasses are listed here. This is different types of pretreatment methods are listed here, okay, the mechanical one, then pretreatment conditions, how much time, okay, and all these things are given here, and what is the efficiency of the process. So, we will just see the first one, okay, the Douglas fir residues. So, the hammer milling, air classifier milling, ball milling, chipped, mashed, all these things has been compared. So, time of residence inside the mill is basically 7 to 30 minutes. The result is that highest yield of glucose and xylose or mannose was obtained after 30 minute of ball milling. So, ball milling decreased the cellulose crystal from 40.73% to 11.7%, which is a significant decrease, okay. So, please have a look later on, okay. Now, the next one, microwave and its application. So, microwave is a type of electromagnetic non-ionizing radiation with frequency between the infrared and radio waves. Microwave radiation absorbed by matter has appropriate energy to excite the vibration of molecules, but its energy is too low to break chemical bonds. The electric field of microwaves transfer their energy to molecules, which leads to the generation of thermal energy. The main advantages of microwave heating versus conventional heating are lower energy consumption, shorter reaction time and avoided contact with the feedstock. On the other hand, the prolonged time of microwave treatment increases degradation of polysaccharides. So, researchers have demonstrated advantages of the application of microwaves in the increase of the yield of biogas in biomethanation of organic matter. This is one of the research which I have listed here. There are many works, okay. So, microwave generated heat increases the solubility of lignin, released soluble compounds and improved the rate of hydrolysis due to cellular disruption. However, the effectiveness of biogas production dependent on the time of exposure and power of irradiation. A longer exposure time can lead to fractional degradation of reducing sugars and the generation of inhibitors negatively affecting the biogas formation. Nevertheless, appropriate time of microwave irradiation of biomass increased cell frangibility and improved enzymatic hydrolysis by disruption of biomass complex structure. It is a good process, it is easy to operate, okay, and not too energy intensive also. So, let us talk about one of its application for converting the switchgrass and miscanthus into alcohol platform. So, microwave pretreatment was effectively applied to reduce the recalcitrance of complex biomass feed structure of switchgrass and miscanthus to enhance their solubility in subcritical water in the hydrogen production in aqueous phase reforming. So, it was done for the hydrogen production process. So, this was possible owing to the action of microwaves on oxygenated polar functional groups present in the biomass structure. Additionally, the temperature pretreatment above 200 degree centigrade accelerated the deconstruction of polymer complexes, leading to delignification as well as partial removal of hemicellulose. It enhanced solubilization of switchgrass and miscanthus, however, this negatively affected the gasification efficiency. So, this table will again let us understand that what are the different types of studies that concerns about the application of microwaves. You can see again switchgrass is there and miscanthus, and then cauliflower and cabbage is also mentioned here. So, there are direct pretreatment and then domestic microwave oven at microwave powers. This is the domestic microwave oven, okay, which is being used here. Time of residence is 15 to 30. You can see that highest increase in biogas production immersed in microwave power of 350 watts in 25 minutes. And another very interesting fact about microwave treatment is that it is a very faster process. Okay. So, time is money in industrial. Okay. So, we should choose such processes which are faster. Okay. So, please have a proper look later on. So, the next one is ultrasound and its application. Application of ultrasounds as a green technology plays a positive role in the efficient production of added value chemicals or biofuels by effective decomposition of recalcitrant lignocellulosic materials. The main advantages of ultrasound pretreatment are shorter processing time, lower operation temperature, and finally, a lower amount of chemicals used during further valorization. Additionally, it has potential to be combined with other technologies. However, the effect of the ultrasound treatment differs depending on the type of lignocellulosic materials. So, one example of grape pomace has been listed here. So, the influence of ultrasound pretreatment on the efficiency of biomass processing was tested for methane production from grape pomace among others. Okay. So, increases of methane yield and kinetic constant of the hydrolysis after the application of ultrasound by almost 10% and 35% respectively were observed in comparison to untreated material. Moreover, pretreatment of grape pomace reduced the amount of hemicellulose and lignin and slightly increased the content of soluble ingredients compared to control samples. Okay. So, it is almost by 13%, 6% and 5%. Respectively. So, the positive effects of ultrasounds on both chemical composition and yield to methane were explained by the presence of the formed cavitation bubbles, which mechanically disrupted the cell wall structure of the lignocellulosic material. So, it is an interesting technology, actually technique. So, a simple one. So, here the cavitation happens by the formation of bubbles, and it will do the disruption of the cellular structure. So, we will see one of the application on the agava leaves. So, researchers showed the effect of ultrasound pretreatment on the physicochemical properties of the agava leaves. Okay. The use of ultrasound for 30 minutes resulted in an increase in the content of holocellulose and lignin and a reduction of extractives and ash in the analyzed material. Now, holocellulose is the amount of water non-soluble carbohydrates basically. Okay. So, moreover, the agava leaves treated for 30 minutes showed enlarged pores and damaged cellular structure. As a result, polymers were more accessible for further processing. The use of ultrasounds resulted in mechanical breaking down of the complex structure of leaves, which led to fracturing of bonds binding lignin, cellulose and hemicellulose. An increase in the sonication time to 60 minutes caused a decrease in the amount of holocellulose and lignin, which was related to the fractionation or breaking down of lignin and hemicellulose molecules. So, that this particular table has given examples of studies concerning the application of ultrasound. You can see again that grape pomace and agava leaves are being ultrasound treated, and the different pretreatment conditions are given. You can see the efficiency of the process. So, the first one in case of grape pomace, okay, less than 25 degree centigrade, almost 40 to 70 minutes the time of residence. So, ultrasound treatment reduced yield of hemicellulose and lignin by 13.3 and 6.3% respectively. Ultrasound pretreatment provided an increase in methane production compared to untreated sample. Moreover, pre-treatment of grass pomace slightly increase the amount of soluble ingredients compared to the control sample. Similarly, in case of the agave leaves, pre-treatment resulted in the production of inulinases and cellulases and a reduction in the amount of extractives and S. These are the enzymes. Okay. So, ultrasound pre-treatment for 30 minutes results in 1.5 to 2 times higher specific enzymatic activity, okay, which is known as SEA of insulinases, but reduces SEA for other enzymes. So, these are some of the classical findings from the ultrasound based treatment. So, now we will discuss the biological approaches to hydrolyze lignocellulosic structures. Biological pretreatment using microorganisms is a promising approach to degrade lignocellulosic structure extracellularly, thus increasing the sugar conversion rate of the biomass. Now, they have several attractive traits such as eco-friendly and simple operation, low capital cost, low energy requirement and almost no chemical requirement. However, the major drawback are the long pretreatment time and strict microbial growth conditions. So, the extraction of lignin degrading enzymes from microorganisms to be used directly on the biomass emerges as an alternative approach to eliminate the above problems. However, efforts in reducing the cost of enzyme extraction are necessary to make it a viable process. So, you can see this. So, this is the schematic representation. So, here the lignocellulosic biomass, any such lignocellulosic biomass treat it with microorganisms. Okay, it can be a single strand microorganism, it can be a microbial consortium also, depends what you are deciding actually. Then again actually it goes for the lignin degradation where and that the top one and here the cellulose decrystallization. Okay, so from cellulose to reducing sugars using the cellulase enzyme, right. So, then of course, you can further ferment them to alcohol platforms. So, cellulolytic and ligninolytic microorganisms. So, the commonly used microorganisms are bacteria and filamentous fungi. As for example, Ascomycetes and Basidiomycetes, which are found ubiquitous in soil, living plants and lignocellulosic waste material. The fungi can be classified into brown rot, white rot and soft rot fungi. Now, these microorganisms secrete enzymes that are capable of selectively degrade lignin. So, they are known as the ligninolytic fungi or hydrolyzed cellulose. So, basically they are known as the cellulolytic bacteria. Now, biological pretreatment using microorganisms and enzymes extracted from them also offer a great opportunity to produce various high value added chemicals from the waste byproduct lignin. Among the microorganisms, white rot fungi have been extensively studied and proven to be one of the most effective lignin degrading species. However, again I am telling you that it is a time consuming process. So, let us talk about the application. So, during their growth, most white rot fungi, whether it is P. osteatus, whether it is T. versicolor, whether it is Phanerochyta crassosporium or whether it is produce extracellular lignin modifying enzymes including lacase, lignin peroxidases which are known as LIPs and manganese peroxidases which are known as MNPs. Now, these are enzymes. Okay. Now, these enzymes exhibit specificity for lignin and catalyze enzymatic cleavage of lignin aromatic rings through oxidation processes and these are all slow processes. So, as a result, the linkages between polysaccharides and lignin are broken down, thus liberating the cellulose component and enhancing the hydrolysis of the lignocellulose. Now, in addition, some of the white-red fungi as mentioned here, as for example, the Phanerochyta crassosporium, okay, secrete cellulitic enzymes known to hydrolyze cellulose, thus increasing its enzymatic digestibility. So, it is happening simultaneously basically, you can say in that spirit. So, some of the different types of fungus, okay, and even bacteria and the feedstock, okay, and the operating conditions and what has happened after the pretreatment process. So, we will see one thing, the white rot fungus, okay, T. versicolor, cow manure and selected cereal crops were being considered. The operation condition is 25 degree centigrade, 135 rpm rotations per minute, okay, 6 days, okay, 75% MC and pH is 4.2. So, the result is 80% increase in cellulose degradation is an excellent result, right, but it has taken time, you can understand that it is 6 days time. Okay. So, 10% to 18% increase in methane yield, right. So, if you look at this particular table in a proper way, you will understand that efficiency is not an issue. The only issue is that it is very time consuming, and then since we are dealing with live organisms, okay, so we have to ensure each and every day that their growth conditions are maintained. So, lignilolytic enzymes, in an alternative approach to microorganism incubation, lignilolytic enzymes extracted from the fungal and bacterial cultures can be purified and used directly on the biomass as a pretreatment. So, here what we are talking about, that instead of using the microorganisms directly, we extract the enzymes which is responsible for this pretreatment, delignification or disintegration, can be extracted and purified, and then it will be used. So, now in this case we are done away with the growth condition of the microorganisms, okay. Only we have to maintain proper conditions for the enzymatic attack onto the microbial cell, onto the plant cell or the biomass cells basically. Now, but please understand that it is a better technique. However, extracting and purifying enzymes from microorganisms is a very tedious job and is a time consuming, as well as it is a high cost matter. So, these lignilolytic enzymes are capable of catalyzing various biochemical reactions to degrade selectively lignin with minimal cellulose consumption. Now, direct application of enzymes on the biomass eliminates the long growing period of microorganisms, thus significantly reducing the pretreatment time. So, 15 to 40 days to almost 6 to 24 hours, that is fine, but again the cost has a bigger role to play. So, as a result, enzymatic pretreatment can accelerate bioenergy production at minimal environmental impacts, no chemical addition and lower energy demand. Modified lignin after enzymatic pretreatment can also be recovered for effective uses in fast pyrolysis to produce bio-oil. This is one of the significant work. So, common enzymes used for pretreating lignocellulosic biomass are mostly commercialized products from leading companies such as DuPont, Novozymes and DSM. So, these are some of the companies who are the enzyme making companies basically, and very well known. Okay. So, the capability to identify microorganisms and growth conditions to cost effectively produce and purify a high amount of stable lignino-lytic enzymes is critical for this pretreatment to be commercially viable. So, major lignino-lytic enzymes such as lacase, LIPS, which is called lignin peroxidase, and MNPs, manganese peroxidase, have been evaluated for their efficiency in delignifying lignocellulosic biomass. Up to 50% lignin removal was attained by pretreatment with P. osteus lacases for high lignin content biomass. So, almost 29 to 33% for coffee silver skin and potato peel respectively. The pretreatment of wheat straw using a P. cinnabarinus lacase achieved almost 37% lignin removal. Okay. So, that is led to an increase in the 60% glucose yield after the enzymatic hydrolysis. Sugarcane bagasse pretreated with a lignolytic enzyme extracted from P. osteus IBL02 strain containing lacase, LIPS and MNPs also reported 34% delignification and ethanol production of 16 grams per liter after the fermentation process. So, this is this table lists some of the properties of the important lignino-lytic enzymes. So, you can see three enzymes are listed here, lacase, LIPS and MNPs, and different types of plant materials, what are the characteristics features and what is the substrate specificity. So, you please go through it later, okay, when you go through the lecture note lecture. So, with this I conclude today's lecture, and tomorrow we will be discussing dilute acid, alkali hydrolysis and ozone treatment, pretreatment methods. Okay. If you have any query, please feel free to write to me at kmohanty@iitg.ac.in, or please register your query in the SWAM portal. So, thank you very much.